Hello everyone, welcome to Vajran Talks. This video will help you understand about what is PDD. Each and every detail within a PDD is discussed, and you also will get to know what is task capture, how to use task capture, create a project with a task capture, and how exactly it can be converted into PDD, and from task capture how even generate the code that you can use in UiPath. Everything is discussed in detail in this particular video. So best option not to skip anything, because each and every point is properly discussed with detail in this particular video. Hope you all will enjoy this particular video. Keep checking and hear how the video goes. Like, share and subscribe. Don't forget to share this video. This will definitely help someone who is looking or who is into RP, who just came into RPA space, who is looking and checking how and what is a PDD and where exactly do we need to create a PDD, how and at what process of life cycle of an RPA project do we need to create a PDD. Before PDD creation, what exactly will happen in detail, everything is discussed. Go ahead and watch it out. Hi Kritika and hi Syed. So hi, what Kritika. Exactly we'll be doing today is we'll be checking out with the task capture activity or task capture application that's provided by UiPath to make business analyst process, as well as people who are trying to fetch the process from the businesses in a more easier manner or more easier way. So where can we get task capture? Task capture is available from UiPath. And once we install task capture, again, not going with how to install task capture because it's one way process. Just go ahead and click on install and it will be installed. So this is basically a task capture application where we can record or we can work in two ways, capture a process and simply check with the template. So let's start with the template and we can go with capture process and let's see with template. So what exactly can we do? So we discussed that we will create a flow to add or to sum two numbers. That's all we will do, nothing else. But what exactly are we trying to do is we are trying to take a process and convert it into a PDD. Okay, before we go and we check with PDD, I would like to ask you guys, what is the use of PDD and how do you find it useful? Why do we need a PDD?
Well, it is useful to sign off, first of all, with the business user. And if we just record the PDD and give it to a developer, on the basis of that, he will just develop the whole solution.
Okay.
Yeah.
So get a clear understanding of what the process is and what the developer would have to do.
Okay.
And map it as per.
So basically, we can say that PDD is some kind of a document where everything stays in the PDD, and that's what we need to follow, nothing else. If it is not in the PDD, it's out of the scope.
Yes.
Okay. So that's what we can say with the PDD as. So again, people who are looking for jobs should know the PDD or shouldn't know the PDD. What exactly can we say for them?
It's a must, I think so. If you don't know the PDD, then the whole process is up and down, I think so.
Okay. So before, can we start a process before creating a PDD?
Well, if you know the basic requirement, you can, but then that is not the proper way to go. You have to go through the document to understand, because there could be a point where there is a certain change. And if the developer misses that particular thing from the document, then that is hectic to again go and start developing.
Yes. So again, why exactly a business user or a process requires a PDD, and at what step does a PDD come into place?
The first step is PDD, I think so.
No, before that is some requirement document.
Okay. So what is the required? So PDD is also a requirement document, right?
No, there are certain documents which I don't remember, but okay. I don't think so. PDD is the first step.
Okay.
I just know that.
Okay, so the first will be a proposal which is from the business leaders to some client that we are going to do this particular work in so much time and this is what you will be charged for. That's what they agree on. The second step will be to actually understand what exactly. So before creating a PDD, even before creating a proposal, a client will come to someone who can create a solution and say that, okay, this is where I have a problem and I want solution and I want this particular problem to be resolved with RPA. That's how it normally works. And while at what step? So initially we need to do some analysis with the process to check with the what we can say is a feasibility check, whether that process can be automated or not. And if the process can be automated, again, how to check if a process can be automated is completely a different story that we cannot cover in this particular discussion. So what exactly should be taken or how exactly should be done is, first go with the process and check if the process is feasible, what's called a feasibility check. And if the process is feasible, then go ahead and implement or create particular steps or as is process, what we are saying. So in the PDD, what do we have? Or I think we have PDD, in the PDD, we'll have as is process and a to be process, right?
Yeah.
So Kritika, what is a to be process and what is an as is process?
Okay. So as is process is the current system. If you have a proposal, developing a certain application, okay, for automating a certain application, you have to first tell that how that application is currently being executed. If it is a manual process, you have to tell in the document that manually how the process is being worked. And to be would be what the client needs from you.
Okay.
So after automating, or once the process is automated, what would be the steps done by the robo, for example, would be the to be process.
Yes. So the complete process in which we should also mention where a robot should come into picture. Let's say that there are 10 steps. In the 10 steps are completely run by a manual person now. Now in the out of those 10 steps, we actually programmed our robot to perform around 7 to 8 steps. Though the remaining steps are being still done by the person, whatever steps can be done or whatever the process can be done by a robot, she's designed in such a way that the bot kicks in and starts the work and gives some output to an end user. That's how it normally is. And if you see here in the table of contents, we should also see in this particular PDD what exactly. So let's go with the table of contents because this is a structure that we can follow and we can discuss more in a structural manner if we go with the table of contents.
Yeah.
So let's go with the key process contact. Who is process key contact? Syed?
It will be the business, I think so.
They okay. So here a process key contacts can be someone from the client who is a subject matter expert and someone who is leading a RPA practice or someone who can be said as a solution architect. Mm-hmm. And also we need to include business analyst as well. And we also need to include a developer as well in this particular key process context, because these are the people who mainly work on this particular process from beginning to the end. Though a developer can be a person who comes in between, develops some piece of code and leaves, but there will be a lead developer who continuously works for the complete process from beginning to the end.
Yeah.
So those details can be mentioned here. And what is minimum prerequisites for automation? So what is minimum prerequisites? What can be updated here?
Automation.
A studio and software, whatever licenses which we require and other software which has to be integrated with RPA.
Okay. And what about you, Kritika?
The same.
The same. So exactly what can we say here is, minimum prerequisites is that you, without these applications, we cannot continue or these are like the showstoppers. If we don't have this, we cannot continue our automation process. So those are can be said as prerequisites for automation, minimum prerequisites. Like if we want to automate Excel application today, so we or if we want to have calculator to be automated today, then obviously we need to have calculator and we need to have Studio installed and with proper license. And we also need to see if we have application access or permission to access the calculator. If we don't have the access, how the bot can work, the bot cannot work on it. So those kind of details to be mentioned. And if you go into the broader scope, let's say that we are working on some kind of web application and that web application need to have a username and password. So we need to properly mention whether the particular username and password are being allocated and how they are allocated. So we cannot directly give a static username and password in the PDD and say that, okay, this is the username and password and go ahead and use it. That's not how a PDD will work. So how exactly it can be done is if we are storing the PDD username and password somewhere, we need to mention where exactly it is stored and how are we going to retrieve those particular things to our automation. That's how it will work. And so Syed, you actually upgraded this particular process overview. So I think if you can give me a particular steps, what exactly are these and how are we going to use this?
The items, right?
Yes.
Yeah. The process full name would be a shop description basically.
Okay.
Yeah. So for example, right now we are developing something related to a calculator.
Okay.
Something related to calculator, we can put into the description that. Okay. And process area would be the division or something which where we are
okay
doing this sort of
so something so in an organization we will have HR department, and in that HR department there will be recruiting process, process area, recruiting and financial area. So again, different departments and different process areas will come into place here. And what about the process short description?
Short description would be this shorter version of the full name, I would say, but it would be a small and something which the end user once reads it knows the whole process.
Not exactly. So for
about example, the process, right? What we have to automate, yeah. And all.
Yes. So what we can say is, if you are trying to automate calculator here, mm-hmm. So what exactly is our process? To add two numbers can be our process. Okay. Add two numbers is my main agenda, mm-hmm. to do. But to do that, I'm using calculator as an application. So the outcome can be sum of two numbers can be the outcome. So here operation and activity can be adding of two numbers, and outcome can be a sum of whatever input that we give can be an outcome. So if we are saying that in a project, an outcome can be of different types. One of the outcome can be a report. The second outcome can be an email that's generated out of a process. Yeah. That can be an outcome. So again, there are different outcomes. They are not limited to one particular process. Each and every process may have different outcomes. Roles required for performing the process, whatever the roles. Okay, what exactly is this?
Roles access related.
Access related, yes, of course it is access related. Like who should have the access for this particular process?
Bot.
Yes, who should have access for this bot? And
from the business end.
Yes, and process schedule and frequency again. This is about when are we scheduling the process, and are we scheduling it on a frequent basis, like with a specific frequency? It should run for every 5 minutes, or it should run. That's a frequency, but if it is scheduled, it means we can say that we need to schedule it at 5 p.m. every day, and it should run at 5 p.m. every day. That's how we are going to have. And number of items processed, what is this? So again, this is a discussion. There is no right or wrong for it. Maybe we can be wrong. People will be there to give Galia in the comments, but let's go. Let's go with whatever we know.
It could be in the current system, how many, for example, if this is a calculator based and on per day basis, we have 10 records. So number of items being processed could be 10 items being processed for that calculator.
Yes. So what is process execution time?
So how much time does it take for that particular record to process?
Manual execution time for that particular process, that's what we can say. And peak periods, what are the peak periods? This is interesting.
When is the data peak periods? When is most of the data being coming to the system so that the process can execute that?
Maybe something like that. If Amazon suddenly gives a offer and suddenly everyone rushes to that particular offer and tries to buy. And at that particular time, there will be a lot of invoices generated. So that will be a peak time that we can say. And transaction volume during the peak period?
What is the amount? As in, estimated, if that is the peak period, then how many records are there? Max to max, maybe.
Even a robot needs a time to process.
Yeah.
So we cannot say that if we give 100 inputs to a robot and it can complete it within seconds. We cannot say that. So every transaction should have its own time. And during the peak process, bots usually fail because of the load or the volume. So we can say, or we are initially saying that, okay, this is what at the max we can handle, or a business, the bot can handle. That's what we are committing for. Or what we can say is, within the peak period, we can get 100. Normally, if we get 10 within the peak period, we'll get 100 and we need to process those particular items. So total number of FTEs?
Number of people doing the job right now.
Exactly. So how many people are exactly supporting this particular activity or particular process, that we can say. And expected increase of volume in the next reference period.
Something forecast related, what exactly, how much of that area is expecting.
So as the business grows, there will be more inputs that may come into picture, or there will be more transactions that may come into picture. Initially, the bot is developed to handle 100 transactions, but later the bot need to handle 1,000 transactions. So how are we going to scale? So yes, we cannot make a bot to do that, but we can keep multiple bots in a bot form to actually take the input, and continuously bots will process from a single queue. That's a idea that we can have. And level of exception rate, what exactly level of exception rate? And with respect to banking scenarios, what should be the level of exception rate?
Depending on how, when the system fails and how many times, and with reference to banking, I don't know.
Okay. You, Syed?
With reference to banking, I have very less experience, but it should be high, I think so.
Yes. So this should be something like this. Normally, if a transaction got completed, or if I'm trying to buy something, okay, if the transaction or if the item is not purchased, that's fine. But if the item is purchased and if I didn't pay the amount, then business will be in loss.
Yeah.
Okay. And in the same way, some banks, even banks, need 100% assurance that the bot will work.
Yes.
Because we cannot say to a business, or we cannot say to the bank that, okay, boss, for 100 members, it will work properly, but for the 11th member, it will not work. If there is something like that, then bank will always have a dilemma of whether to accept that or not.
Mm-hmm.
Because the 101 transaction can be 100 times what exactly the 100% are doing. Mm-hmm. So if there is an exception rate at that level, they cannot actually take chances on that particular scenario. So using in banking scenarios, it will be around 0 or less than 1%. And where it is acceptable can also be mentioned or should be mentioned in the PDD. And in normal scenarios, generally a report should be generated on every month or every week. then again, that can be like, even if the first time it fails, in the day before SLA, it can generate a second report and it can give us the result. So that can be an exception, level of exception, right? So out of 10 items, maybe if one item fails, then we have one item as an exception rate. So 10% is the exception rate out of 10 items. Okay, so input data and output data. What is input data and what is output data?
In case of calculator, there would be the numbers and output would be the operation performed, if it's addition, then the result of that. So it is, input is the data what we have and the operation performed on that particular process. After the operation has been performed, we get the output. So that is the result.
Okay, so let's think in terms of a report generation. Yeah. And the report generation, let's have an Excel as an input. Mm-hmm. And finally, the email can be an output. So here the input data changes now. We can have multiple inputs again. It need not be only one input. It can be multiple Excels, or it can be from different inputs, like it, one report or one item from the a website, and other can be from an application internally inside the organization. So finally, we need to check whether both the data are correct or matching or not. Finally, we need to send an email as a report that these are not matching and check with the result to someone who can validate or who has authority to validate it. So something like that can be taken as an input and an output data. Okay. And so again, if these items should not be left blank, and if there is no data or something that shouldn't be updated, then we can mention it as NA, not applicable for that particular scenarios. So again, what, so Syed, let's go with you again. What is applications used in the process with the calculator?
Calculator, application, and UiPath.
Okay. So again, we cannot mention UiPath as a process because that's a studio that we are using.
Oh, sorry. Yeah.
So what we can say is an Excel can be an application that we will be using, where we will maintain the data in the Excel and we'll fetch the data from Excel. And we'll use application called calculator to do the calculation and finally write it back to Excel.
Email or Excel, yeah.
So this here we can say that applications can be two applications, one with
Excel,
calculator, and the other with Excel, right? Okay, let's go with as-is process. So Kritika, what can be as-is process here?
As this process, we open the calculator, we enter the data, we extract whatever's the output, and we manually enter it into the Excel sheet, and then we mail it.
Exactly. And what can be a to-be process?
To-be process would be bot reading the particular data Excel sheet and extracting all the input, and then opening the calculator, and for each record, just entering the input, extracting the output, writing it back to the Excel. And then once the process is completed, it can mail that particular Excel.
Excellent. Now let's go with the process statistics. Again, these, if we are manually doing this, if we want to check it one by one, again, it will be a lot of time to actually check with every click. But using task capture, I think we are getting everything in one step. Like how many windows are we using? How many steps are being performed? Mm-hmm. And how many mouse clicks are being taken, and what are the key presses that we are doing. If you are doing some text entries and hotkeys, I think this is one of the best way where we can exactly check how many actions are being performed on this particular process. Okay. And again, here detailed statistics, I think it is going with respect to applications, how many clicks are being performed on a calculator. And if we also have some other application like Notepad, what are we doing in a Notepad? Something like that. That's what I assume. Okay, details as is process. Okay, so these are the steps that are available for us. But again, if we go with this, then we will not be able to check with task capture. So we'll see something here. Okay, here if you see step number in the process, legend is what we can say. And if it is a robot, the process being proposed for automation. And if it is human, then again, so again, this process document should be built by a human again. Though the robot gives us everything, this particular document should be built by a human and should be given to a human to develop. So to make the process easily to understand, whenever a bot comes in and kicks in, we are mentioning that this is the logo that you are going to see, and if it is a human that's going to work on, then human is what we can check it here. So what is parallel initiatives and what is an overlap? No idea?
No idea.
Ayad?
No.
No idea. Okay. So parallel initiative can be like this. Okay. Let's say that a process need to do addition. Some other process need to do multiplication. And the third process need to do subtraction. Simple things. But there should be in a that should be done in a sequence, or there should be an overlap. Maybe after taking first value, it should come to the second process and give the value of addition to multiplication, and with multiplication there will be one more item that will be added and multiplied, and that will be given to subtraction, and from subtraction take the output from multiplication and subtract something and give the details. So this is like a chaining of process, but here we don't have an overlap. Okay, but in regular business scenarios, one person will wait a report, and multiple reports need to be generated from multiple bots. Mm-hmm. And each and every process need to have one person who need to check with the process whether the process is being executed properly or not.
Yeah.
So there we will have parallel initiatives, like a bot need to fetch details from Amazon, and another bot need to fetch details from Wikipedia, and some other bot need to take both the values and keep end result. So parallel executions here are what we can say. Wikipedia extraction and Amazon extraction can be a parallel process that are being taken and which can come into place. And here initiative name, maybe we can keep a process name, process steps where it is identified. Okay, maybe if we are going in deep with the process, we can check impact on the current automation request and how exactly. Let's say that Wikipedia report is not getting generated. So the third process is what impacted here.
Yeah.
Not the first process, which is a Amazon process. Okay. So what is the impact on the third process, which is creating a report? That's what we need to mention. Expected completion date. So whatever the exceptions or whatever the completion date that we agree to the business, I think that. And contact person for more details. If there is an exception or if there is some issue that happened, whom we need to contact. That's what I think we need to mention here. Too much of data to be processed in a PDD. Yes.
Then what is overlap? Are they similar, parallel initiatives and overlap?
Parallel initiatives or overlap?
So what is overlap? I mean, both are same, you're saying.
So again, see, overlap is something like before third execution, which creates a report, there is an overlap of Wikipedia report that's need to be generated.
Okay,
that's like though we have parallel initiatives like Amazon and Wikipedia, but those are dependent, or those reports are dependent on the third process which creates a report.
Okay.
That I'm thinking again. In scope of RPA, what is the in scope? So these are the important things while we are creating some PDD, because if we don't mention in scope and what is out of scope, suddenly business will come and say that, okay, I have already said this, but you didn't implement. Why didn't you implement? So these kind of issues can come into place. So that's the reason we can mention what is in scope for RPA and what is not in the scope of RPA. So Kritika, what can be in scope for this particular calculator operation?
You mean the steps, as in how the application would be processing?
Whatever you say that, I don't have. See, you are the drivers for this particular question.
Okay. So in scope would be the bot accessing the calculator application, entering the data. Only numbers, no alphabets, and in case of scientific calculator, that is the later part. But since if it's basic operation, then numbers is in scope and not alphabet. then extracting the result and writing the output in the Excel application and sending back to the mail. So what is not in, that's it.
So let's ask Syed, what is out of the scope? Normally in business scenarios, what can be out of the scope?
Normally it's like the availability of the system shouldn't be hanged and all those things, those sort of stuff. That's the exception, sorry.
That is exception.
Okay, so to what I have in mind, let's say that we need to automate a application, but maintenance of the application is not in our scope.
Okay,
let's say that there are updates that are being performed on that particular application. Doing an update on the application is not in our scope. And if the update is happened and if there are any changes, then again, that will be out of the scope because bot will not be able to handle those issues or handle those particular scenarios. Because let's say that in this calculator, all of a sudden there is an upgrade and the calculator, all the IDs gets changed, all the positions gets changed. So those kind of things can be out of the scope of RPA.
Yes.
So whatever we document and we say that, okay, this is what we are trying to do, only that can be in the scope for RPA process. Okay. So what exactly here we are mentioning out of scope is, this is an example. Let's say that there is an input and the input can be a list of PDF documents. Okay. And the PDF document can be digitally available or it can be handwritten, maybe a scanned copy. Yeah. So what exactly is given as an example here is whatever digitally available document is available, which can be readable by PDF activities or which can be readable by UiPath, can be taken as an in scope. But if it is a document that is specific to handwritten document or something that is related to image, so we are creating some expectations with the business as well as with our solution designers or solution architects that this is what will happen and out of this will not be available or which we cannot support. That's what we are coming to one idea about. Possible measures to consider in future of automation: collect the form in editable format and electronically signed. So that's what I mentioned here. So the measure should be taken as, don't give me handwritten documents. We are saying business that, okay, boss, you gave me or you requested me only to give data with electronically signed or something that is digitally acceptable. If you are not giving that, we cannot do it for you. Okay, what is business exception handling? So this is one beautiful concept where this should be taken for sure in businesses. Let's go with calculator and let's elaborate it in broader scope. So what
divide by zero error, that could be a business exception where a particular data has zero, for example. Okay, this is a different example where a data has zero and you have to perform operations and eventually that will result to zero. So that could be a business exception. Then sure. Second, anything divide by zero error exception. Those are the two things which I can think of.
So what exactly can be, okay, let's leave about calculator automation now. Let's go with a regular scenarios. Mm-hmm. What can be a business rule exceptions and how are we handling them?
When the process owner says that it should be handled in such a way that this doesn't come into the process, so you need to leave these things. That's when we just put it into exception.
Yes. Okay. So
it's a known one.
Yes. Known exception. Okay. This is already known. No need to worry about it. Even if this exception is available with a bot, let's go ahead and continue further.
Yes.
So a broader explanation can be, let's take example of what Kritika has said. Now, in the input form, which we are taking as an Excel, there can be multiple operations: addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division. but user asks or user says that whichever number should be divided by zero, raise it as an exception. Don't process that because there is no need for us to process. Why am I getting hidden sometimes?
You have to sit straight, maybe.
Okay, so I don't want to turn off my background. Okay, let it be like this. Okay, so what exactly can be taken is, so these are the scenarios that business already knows that, okay, these are the applications or these are the scenarios where you will have an exception or where you need not process that particular transaction. So those can be taken as an input. And if we have such transactions, let's say that Syed and Kritika and me are working in an organization and I developed a bot and I set the bot to, okay, if someone is coming for less than or attending to the work for less than 20 days, don't raise the payslip for them. And all of a sudden, Kritika did not attend the office for 20 days continuously in that month. So what the bot does is, see, bot has all its capabilities to run the process or to create the report or to generate the payslip. But since I raised a business exception that, okay, someone didn't come for 20 days, this should be taken to HR to know what are the reasons. So instead of bot handling it, it will go and raise an exception and give a report that this is the exception that you, that we have, and you need to check further. Okay. And let's go with known exceptions. What are known exceptions?
With the business already prescribing it.
So we have already said what are known, what is business exceptions and what are known exceptions.
So the one, the example which you gave that after 20 days, if doesn't, that is a known exception.
No, that's a business rule exception, right? How can that be a known exception?
Okay. So this comes, known and unknown exception comes under business exception, right?
So known and unknown exceptions are different things.
So business rule exception is different, known is different, unknown is different, right?
Completely different.
Okay. So known system, no, turns off, system shuts, system is not responsive. That would be application.
That was a system.
That would be application.
That's an application. Of course, that's it's an application, but...
Okay,
again, see, what can we say with these known exceptions are, while we are executing a bot or while executing a process, sometimes there will be a pop-up, unnecessary pop-up that can come into place.
Okay.
That can stop a bot to process further or that can stop a transaction to continue further. So this is a known exception. The business knows that, okay, there will be a pop-up that comes at different point of time, which is completely not known and which cannot be automated. So that's a known exception. And anything which we don't know can be said as an unknown exception.
Okay.
Okay. So for all other unanticipated or unknown issues, so even we don't know, so we cannot say whatever exception that may occur. So those are unknown exceptions. Okay, application error and exception handling. What exactly do you do if there is an application error, and how can we write this?
If there is an application error, we retry, restart the system and again try from where it had stopped using a try catch. So yeah, that is detailed development though.
Again, this here we cannot say that use try catch or use
it. That's what I said. It's detailed development, which I said.
Yes. So, Syed, if you have better answer.
Yeah, when a application closes or freezes off.
Okay.
At that point of time, the bot doesn't work usually. So, it shutdowns the whole, kills all the application and then restarts all the applications and then can start processing it. So that's how usually it, we program it.
So we can define to retry it an n number of time, and after that n number time has reached, maybe we can report it to the business that this particular system has failed.
So more likely, so again, we are going into development perspective. According to business perspective, what exactly can be said is, if there is an application error, retry it 3 times. Don't go in details. Okay. And even if it fails, then raise an exception or throw an error and continue for the next item.
Yeah.
So here we have an exception and we are also handling the exception. So that's how we need to document this particular item and comprehensive. So here again, we need to mention if it is a technology or application exception, or if it is a server exception, or if it is an internet issue, maybe if it can be, and whatever the applications exceptions are available, we need to mention here. Again, this here, we are having a complete detailed data just to make sure we have everything at one place, unknown errors and exceptions for all other unanticipated errors. What should robot do? If there is any error that comes, which we did not configure, what exactly the bot need to do? So with your understanding or with your experience, Sami, your use case, like if you, did you come across these kind of unknown errors anytime?
Errors.
Don't say no.
To, no, we definitely come across those kind of
errors. Okay.
So related to the application, like earlier you said that the IDs had changed. So that was not known for us that the update to a particular application would have been done.
Yes.
So that was unknown and we didn't know about it. And there was an exception and the process did fail.
Yes. So how are you handling that?
If it's related to selectors, obviously we have to start doing the development again.
Okay. So we cannot say that this is selector, right? This is completely an unknown exception. We are not sure if it is selector application, selector error or anything else. Mm-hmm. Okay. Now what I can do is stop execution of the bot immediately.
Yeah.
Because as we continue to execute for more than 3 times or more than, so let's, this, some example can be like this. The password expiry, if we did not configure it properly, then it leads to application lock.
Yes.
So many applications will have, if you enter more than 3 times a wrong password, then it will lead to application, that particular user ID gets logged for 30 minutes. So again, this need to be configured and this need to be made well aware for the business that this is the password policy that you need to follow. And if they are not following such policy, then it will obviously come to unknown errors because they never thought of it. So immediately we need to send screenshots or we need to send reports to respective stakeholders who are being mentioned at the top. Okay, reporting. What is reporting? Important thing of all the process flows or everything. What is reporting?
After the process executes the data that it has executed.
Okay.
So if it puts the data in the orchestrator, then we can get logs from there. So how do you, once if the process executes daily, then you can get the report daily and send it to business, if weekly, depending on how the business wants the report.
Exactly. So again, if we go in detail with the steps that are available, we have process logs, transaction logs, error logs. So again, process logs are something like how many works, how many robots are being worked on for each and every process. Okay, so this can be a monthly update that can be done to a business user. But if there are error logs that need to be updated daily, because if we have an error, then obviously business should know why there is an error.
Yeah.
Because if we don't know what error are we working on with, then the process obviously fails for the next runs.
Yes.
Okay, and include business below any other relevant observations you consider need to be documented here. Not sure what we need to write. Maybe we can write not applicable for this. Additional sources of process documentation. Video recording of a process. Okay, and standard operating procedure. Okay, additional process documentation. So these are the documents that we need to create. Business rules library is what we need to create, and we need to insert it into this particular PED. And any other documentation, if we have, then that process we need to create. Like if we have mapping file, that where we are mapping folder structure in a particular place, that we need to mention here, and any recording of the process that can be mentioned here. So this PDD, as I have said, it's like the source for all our data. It should be the source for all our data. Mm-hmm. Anytime we need to go back and check why there is an error, this should be the place where we can come back.
Yeah.
Man, it's 1 hour. And we just discussed about the process and we didn't do anything on the documentation, especially. I think we need to connect again for discussing or digging in detail to this particular process. So what shall we do in next 5 to 10 minutes?
Just dive into that.
What do you say, Kritika? Let's go and quickly create a task capture.
Task capture, yeah.
Because that's what we.
That's important. Yeah, exactly.
Because
the video is something else, and we are just sticking to the document, so we need to show them the practical approach also.
Okay, let's go with the task capture and let's do something with calculator. Okay, let's go and close everything and. So here, okay, let's go with the new file. Let's go to the new item. Let's create a simple template and then we can add. So start, and what do we need to do? Add an event. If there is any event, we can add.
Add a sequence.
Okay, let's add an end finally. And let's add a sequence here. What exactly need to be done? So here, this is an empty sequence. So this empty sequence can be what we can exactly take, addition of two numbers. That's a simple thing that we can do. Capture actions now. So when we start capture actions now, it will start immediately. But before that, I think we need to go and start the application.
Application, yeah.
So let's stop it first and let's add one more sequence or add a sequence. What can we do? I think, again, I'm doing it for the first time. Not sure if I can do it properly, but let's try it. So task capture action. So what we can exactly say here is, let's pause it for some time and let's go to calculator. So here we can say that click on calculator is what we can take. And then next step is to add first number. So this is the first number and we can click on next plus, which is the summation, and we can go with the next number. So adding of two numbers. Finally, click on equal to, which gives us the sum, and
extract the result.
Take the output. Okay, and copy the result. Okay. So that's what we need to do. So let's see how the steps are being configured and how did we get the values. And at the end, I think we can close the application, finally close the calculator. Simple process steps. So if you see here again, okay, additional two steps, there is nothing much that's given here. But if you see on the right side, step title, what we can say here is open calculator. Okay, and here what can be taken? And click on the first number.
Yeah, click on the first number.
Okay, and click on operator.
Mm-hmm.
And let's go with the step title here. And click on the second number. And let's go with
operator again.
click on equal to. So since this is calculator, we are able to do it fast. But once this is an application, we need to mention that, like, click on extract report or click on submit. So that's what we need to exactly write. And here we can exactly say here that output will be generated after clicking on equal to. Then here click on this. So here it's mentioned that click on 7 plus 6. What we can say is activate the result window, or click on the result window. Okay. So if you see here, we are also getting the description, clicking on one particular item. And what do we have here? Okay. Let's go copy the result. Copy the result. And what else do we have? I think that's it here.
We were actually right-clicking, right? We did right-click and selected copy.
So I think here, instead of copying the result, we can say select
the result area.
Select the result area. And what else do we need to do? Right-click or copy, use keyboard shortcut or?
Perform copy operation rather.
Maybe perform copy operation. One method is use keyboard shortcut.
Or mouse clicks.
Cut or use mouse operations. And once it is done, close the calculator.
Yeah.
Simple process, right? So we completely updated all the details, like whatever we want to do. So this is how it works. If I add a different sequence to a different item, let's say that after adding everything, if the result is more than 5, then do something.
Mm-hmm.
And if the result is less than 5, then do the other things. So that we can mention as a decision box. But for now, let's go ahead and hit on export or publish. So whenever we click on export and publish, what we can give a title, calculator process flow or addition using calculator process flow. And the description can be something, and I can write Vajrang, Kritika and Syed. So these are the authors that I can give, and gives me sum of two numbers. Simple. And about document properties, here we have multiple options. We have UiPath PDD template that we can create. And if I want to edit the template, we can also use edit template and edit it. Not going into deep. Let's take it in a different discussion. We can take that in a different discussion. And we have two different templates, UiPath PDD and Automation Hub PDD. So whatever we saw earlier is Automation Hub PDD. Let's go with UiPath PDD now. Okay, let's click on UiPath PDD. And here we can also select what is the resolution of the images. Give it a maximum size. But if we increase the size of the image, then the document size also increases.
Yes.
Okay, and sizes, let's go to 100%. So it takes the 100% width of the document. That's what it is. And let's click on export. Okay, let's click on export. It's basically asking me one particular place where I can store. Let me give you a document place. PDD creation, PDD webinar, and click on save. Once the document gets generated, it gives me a copy path and open a file directly. I can do that. Okay, before going digging deep into this, we have one more option. What is it? Create a skeleton for us.
Okay.
Okay, So this is what I like most with task capture. It makes life so easy.
What, it gives the code?
Yes, it gives.
There's no challenge in development.
We should invest more time in PDD then.
Of course.
The BA has more job than the developer.
He need to properly check. Maybe selectors are something that need to be updated. But see here.
Nice.
Okay. Let's check with these details. I thought that maybe I will get the screenshots, which I am not getting. But why don't we just go ahead and execute this and see what exactly happens. Yeah. Okay, let's open calculator, which is again empty one. And let's keep debug. Let's go with debug file and let's see. Excited to see if this works really or not.
Yeah.
It's interesting. Saves the developer's job. The developer's job is at risk now.
No. See, the bot is not working now.
Oh, is it? Then it's not at risk.
Yeah, but still, it says skeleton. That's the reason.
Yes, it's just a skeleton so that we can go and fetch further details. We have all the process that's available. And with the document, we have everything.
Share your screen. Also.
Yes.
Yeah. Are you sharing your screen?
Yeah.
Can you see the screen now?
Yes.
Okay. So here, whatever data that we have given, it's updated. Table of contents, which is a normal structure. Okay. And here, see, we have all our names here. And again, process full name, short description. And here it also says, what is the execution time? How much time did we record the process?
Yeah.
And what else do we have from this? Here again, we have 9 steps that are included, which has the process time of, again, this is an image. So whatever steps we did, we calculated, everything is updated. Estimated time is 51 seconds. And every click is updated. Whatever clicks are available, click on the first number. I think there should be images, which I think we are not getting, but let's see. Why aren't we getting those? Okay. So here it is updated. Maybe the size of the image is too big that you need to come into the next page. Okay. Maybe I can do something for that, but we got everything that is required for a business user as well as a developer. Particle structure is available for us. And I have my power back. Okay. So how is it?
Yeah, it's wonderful. Again.
It's really helpful actually.
Okay. So
a few questions around this.
Yes. What are the questions? Let's go ahead and take the questions and let's close.
Yeah. So for example, we have a process and we don't have access to that particular portal or whatever. So how to, before developing, we create a PDD. So should we install task capture in a process owner's laptop and get all those things?
We can do that.
How would you plan?
Adding a task capture in the process owner laptop or process owner machine and asking him to, okay, perform whatever actions you want to perform and give me the proper description. Okay. Because again, a BA or someone need not take all the screenshots here.
Yeah.
Okay. So there that's where it can come into place.
Yes.
So is this UI part task capture dependent on that studio? Or if we don't have the studio, we can use the task capture?
Absolutely. Yes.
Okay.
This is not dependent on studio.
Yeah. We need to explore more on the PDD template. What if we have our own PDD template, for example, just a logo and minor changes in the sense.
So again, here in the Word document, we can also
we have something
update.
Like import.
So here, if you see, there is import template where we can create a import template.
Yes.
Again, it will be a bigger discussion or
exactly.
out of the scope
we
item
to,
now.
Yeah.
Out of the scope for our RPA discussion for now. So this is a default template. You want to generate a copy of it and delete. Okay, don't do it. Let's go with this and let's go ahead and create export. So let's go with hub and let's see what exactly are we having. Completed, open the file. So let's see. Okay, so here we have it altogether a different structure. Like as is process, what is as is process and applications used. So again, most of the things might be same, but the representation might be different. So that's how things are getting done. I think, what do you think? I think you created some PDDs and how did you feel with this particular task capture?
Time is reduced comparatively as compared to follow the traditional approach. This year the time has reduced.
Absolutely, that's correct.
Yes, totally agree. And the manual effort, because over here usually we have a problem with both agreeing on a time, and it usually takes 2 weeks for us to just to make PDD available. So this would be very useful. In one meeting, maybe we can just get all the requirements and process going forward.
Yes.
Earlier, it would have been more than 1 week for us, at least 2 weeks.
Yes, and the one more important thing is, if we want to update, like if we save it, I saved it at particular place, so this will be saved as a process document, and if I want to open it again and if I want to edit it, I can go ahead and do that as well.
Okay, as a project you can even edit and then republish it.
Yes.
Okay. That's great. That's nice.
Good thing, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Yes. Let's stop our discussion. Hope we had something very exciting to discuss, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So I'll inform you. If you're free, you can connect again whenever I'm doing session on this task capture.
Yes.
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
And
sure.
Let's connect again. Bye-bye, guys. Have
bye
fun.
Bye.
Thank you. Take care. Bye-bye. Bye.
Yeah.